Before we start reading the paragraph beginning with "We shall understand better," I'll read out to you what he has said earlier. Okay, not in Sri Aurobindo's words, but easier words, I hope. So, in the previous para, he has discussed what he's saying is this: is matter as we perceive it with our five senses a reality? That he's asking, he's discussing that in the previous para. No, it is not, because our senses are limited and give us only partial images of the physical world. Example, our eye does not see the ultraviolet and infrared. Our ear does not hear high decibel and low decibel sounds, which bats and dogs can hear. Also, in comparison with higher states of consciousness, the material world appears as mere images, shadows. Okay, so science says that matter is nothing but energy. It is quite right, but this is a partial truth. When spiritual experience reveals matter to be pure, subtle substance, which is conscious of itself at its origin, then we have a greater truth. Science is saying matter is energy, but they are not talking of consciousness. Whereas spiritually we are saying that it is energy, but conscious energy. So it makes a huge difference. And then, now the question crops up: why should spirit take form of matter and not rest content with pure energy, or settle itself into states of velleities of joys? Velleities are mild desires and mild wantings. Okay, so we are told by certain philosophies that matter is a creation of sense. Okay, senses send data to the manas, the physical mind, which interprets the data into visual, auditory, olfactory, gustatory, and tactile experiences. If senses do not exist, the world does not exist for the individuals. But this is not acceptable, because the universe existed before man or animal. So there must be a universal mind, not an individual mind which is creating the world, but a universal mind which is creating the world, which has created matter for the habitation of the spirit. This implies a creative power. But why should spirit create matter at all in the first place? This is the question he has raised in the previous para. Now we start reading the para that we have to read today. Okay, so we shall understand better if we go back at once to the original principle of things. Existence is, in its activity, a conscious force which presents the workings of its force to its consciousness as forms of its own being. Since force is only the action of one sole existing conscious being, its results can be nothing else but forms of that conscious being. Substance or matter then is only form of spirit. So this is the first definition of matter. Substance or matter, note he is using substance, matter, because matter is dense substance, whereas substance can be also subtler and subtler as you keep going up. Substance or matter then is only form of spirit. Spirit itself is formless, but matter is form of spirit. The appearance which this form of spirit assumes to our senses is due to that dividing action of mind, from which we have been able to deduce consistently the whole phenomenon of the universe. So there is the substance, matter, and conscious force creates forms, and it is the power of mind to give specific forms, because it divides that infinite matter into different forms. The appearance which this form of spirit assumes to our senses is due to that dividing action of mind, from which we have been able to deduce consistently the whole phenomenon of the universe. We know now that life is an action of conscious force, of which material forms are the result. Life involved in those forms, appearing in them first as inconscient force, evolves and brings back into manifestation as mind, the consciousness which is the real self of the force and which never ceases to exist in it even when unmanifest. We know also that mind is an inferior power of the original conscious knowledge or supermind, a power to which life acts as an instrumental energy. For descending through supermind, consciousness or chit represents itself as mind, force of consciousness or tapas represents itself as life. Mind, by its separation from its own higher reality in supermind, gives life the appearance of division, and by its further involution in its own life force, becomes subconscious in life and thus gives the outward appearance of an inconscient force to its material workings. Therefore, the inconscience, the inertia, the atomic disaggregation of matter must have their source in this all-dividing and self-involving action of mind by which our universe came into being. As mind is only a final action of supermind in the descent towards creation, and life an action of conscious force working in the conditions of the ignorance created by this descent of mind, so matter as we know it is only the final form taken by conscious being as a result of that working. Matter is substance of the one conscious being, phenomenally divided within itself by the action of a universal mind. The division which the individual mind repeats and dwells in, but which does not abrogate or at all diminish the unity of spirit or the unity of energy or the real unity of matter. Quite a big para. You have to.
There's one footnote also.
Yeah. So there is that footnote which is there. So we read the footnote. Okay. Now, universal mind. Okay. So actually, this is a definition. You can say this is the second definition. First definition he has given. Second definition is there are several definitions of matter. Matter is substance of the one conscious being, phenomenally divided within itself by the action of a universal mind. And that mind, he is explaining, mind is here used in the widest sense, including the operation of an overmind power, which is nearest to the supramental truth consciousness and which is the first fountain of the creation of the ignorance. So, it's the overmind which starts the dividing action of mind. That's what he's saying. So, even our mind also is dividing, but at a lower level. But the real division in the universal matter is at the overmind consciousness. So, shall we go back to the beginning? Okay. So, he's saying, why at all should matter be created at all? That's the question he is asking. And he's asking this question. So, I go back to the last one. This implies that, but why should spirit create matter at all in the first place? This is the question he is going to answer. We shall understand better if we go back at once to the original principle of things. Now, which is the original principle of things? Satchidananda. Okay? So he is saying in terms of Satchidananda, we will try and explain what is Sat, what is Chit, what is Supermind. He has not mentioned, but Ananda and Supermind. Existence is in its activity a conscious force which presents the workings of its force to its own consciousness as forms of its own being. Let's try and understand this. Okay. So, first of all, existence. Okay. Existence is Sat. Sat is substance. Satless substance. That is Sat. Okay. So, but it can be inactive and it can be active. When you are going into the self, that substance is inactive. The Sankhya philosophy calls it the pradhana. It is that which is stable, and like the water behind the dam, it is permanently stable. It is silent infinite, eternal, featureless. This is existence. Wherever you go, it will be the same. There is only oneness there. So that is existence. But it can go into activity also. That's the whole question. This is what Ramakrishna also says. Spirit is water without movement. The moment that water starts making waves and becoming haladola, he uses the word making waves, it becomes a universe. So there is the difference between spirit and matter. Okay?
That's why universe is called Jagat.
Yes, that which is that's moving. Right, that's right. Jagat. Gam and Jagat, that which is constantly moving. Again, it's a frequentative, they call it in Sanskrit. That which is repeated, okay. Jagat. So, existence is in its activity. Now it is that existence, that substance is becoming waves. And where is that activity? It's a conscious force, which presents the workings of its force to its own consciousness as forms of its own being. Let's try and understand this, okay? So, there is Sat, Chit, Shakti, Ananda. Okay? Now, Chit, consciousness and force is working this substance. It takes the substance and starts making forms out of it. And it is presenting it to, the force is acting under the guidance of consciousness. Consciousness is telling the force to create forms, and force is creating, Prakriti is creating the forms and presenting them to consciousness for enjoyment. Okay? And where is it doing it? Within itself. Because Satyananda is the only thing that exists in the world. So it is not that it is creating out of itself. It is creating within itself. This is the explanation for the cosmic consciousness also. When you go there, everything you see is within yourself only. Okay? So, existence is in its activity. Note, when it is active.
Yes.
When it is inactive, it is something else. In its activity, a conscious force which presents the workings of its force, force is making the forms, to its consciousness as forms of its own being. Own being, its own substance. Sentence clear now?
Yes.
It's quite complex. Okay, so, in other words, if you want to put it in a, consciousness is telling force, this he says elsewhere, consciousness tells force, I give you the permission to create forms. And force obeys and creates forms for what? For the enjoyment of Purusha. Purusha is consciousness. And from where is this thing coming? It is using the substance of being or existence or Sat. They are all the same. Okay? So I'll read that sentence again. If put in these words, it becomes a little difficult to understand. Existence is in its activity a conscious force which presents the workings of its force to its consciousness as forms of its own being. Okay? Since force is only the action of one sole existing conscious being, its results can be nothing else but forms of that conscious being. Change conscious being into substance. And read the sentence. Since force is only the action of one sole existing conscious being. Just now we discussed that existence is one. There is nothing else. And it is everywhere the same. Okay? One sole existing conscious being, but this substance is conscious. That's why he keeps on repeating conscious. Okay? So, sole existing conscious being, its results can be nothing else but forms of that conscious being. These forms also that it's creating are conscious at that level. As it keeps coming down, that consciousness becomes less and less and less. Finally, you have forms in the physical world which seem to have no consciousness. There is a consciousness hidden. Okay? So, there's a consciousness even in the stone. But you can't see it, and it is also in sleep. This consciousness is sleeping. So, its results can be nothing else but forms of that conscious being. Substance or matter. Now again, you see, matter is really substance, the grossest substance. Then is only form of spirit. Spirit itself is formless. Matter becomes form of spirit. Okay? So, the appearance which this form of spirit assumes to our senses is due to that dividing action of mind from which we have been able to deduce consistently the whole phenomena of the universe. Now he is using the word appearance. Okay? You have to understand this. The one is becoming the many. Okay? So think of a kaleidoscope. The kaleidoscope, there are only a few beads in the center, but there are six mirrors, and when you are looking in the kaleidoscope, it becomes six. But these are only appearances, they are not the truth. The truth is only the thing in the center. So that's why it becomes appearance. It becomes only an image, it's not the reality. The physical world is only images, not reality, appearances. But one thing, Sri Aurobindo says matter is real, how to explain that? Behind the appearance, there is the reality again. So, it's a very graded thing. At our level, we are seeing the form and we are saying this is real. But it is not so. The form is only appearance. This appearance becomes obvious when you go to the spiritual level of consciousness. I have to tone down. So, at our level, we are seeing the form, real form, as appearance. No, we see it as real. Take the mind to the spiritual levels of consciousness, higher mind, illumined mind, intuitive mind. Now you see, oh, this is only an appearance. So he declares the world to be unreal. Go to the supramental level, behind the appearance, there is a divine reality. So there are three levels. That is what we have to understand. Okay? So these three levels are very important. How does Sri Aurobindo say that the physical world is real? In this sense, okay, that behind even the appearance there is a reality. Okay? Now we go to the next sentence. So that's why he's saying appearance. The appearance which this form of spirit assumes to our senses is due to that dividing action of mind. Now, that mind, it divides. It is the overmind is dividing at the universal level. Our individual mind is also dividing at our individual level. Okay? That's why the Buddhists say that your mind is creating the universe. So there is one small defect there, as Sri Aurobindo points out. The mind is creating the universe, okay, for you. But you have only come into the picture now. The matter existed before. So then he says it's not individual mind, but universal mind. That's what he says. Okay?
Sorry. Angada, in this sentence, I thought that our senses due to that dividing action of mind.
Yes.
Then the use of this word from was a little confusing. I thought that equally it could be replaced by, for the sake of understanding, due to that dividing action of mind, by which we have been able to deduce consistently the whole phenomenon of the universe. Means by the dividing action of mind. But instead of by, you're using from, which is slightly unusual, English-wise.
But essentially it means the same, na?
Yes.
Essentially,
due to that dividing action of mind from which we have been able to deduce.
The dividing action of mind, you discover that when you go right up to the overmind level. You go to the overmind level, you see that is the one that is creating the. Because that's why he says, even up to the overmind level, there is the ignorance. He will tell you that in the paragraph itself here. Okay, so. Alright. So, deduce consistently the whole phenomenon of the universe. We know now. That life, now he is telling you the correspondences. We know now that life is an action of conscious force. Chit Shakti becomes the vital. Chit Shakti becomes the life, prana. Okay? Of which material forms are the result. So, life is creating, now he is talking of the involution. Overmind is creating, the supermind is creating the mind. Mind is creating life. And life is creating matter. It's not that life, matter is creating life. In the involution, it is life that is creating the matter. That is more true than in the evolution, matter is creating life, but the other one is more fundamentally true. Okay? Because the evolution is in time, whereas the involution is not in time. It is something eternal outside time. Okay? All evolution is in time. But actually, that also is timeless because there is no starting point for the. It's a little beyond our normal comprehension. It's not very easy to understand. So, anyway, we know now that life is an action. By the way, how is he saying we know now? because he has discussed all this in the previous chapters. Okay, he has discussed life in detail, 4 chapters on life. So we know now that life is an action of conscious force, of which material forms are the result. Life involved in these forms, appearing in them first as inconscient force, evolves and brings back into manifestation as mind the consciousness which is a real self of the force, which never ceases to exist in it even when unmanifest. So he's saying, Satchananda involving itself, mind creates life, life creates matter, but it is not simply creating. Life enters into matter. Mind also is entering into life and into matter. Again, we come back to that Russian doll. Okay, let's say. So it is always there, even when unmanifest in a stone, life is there present. That's what it's mentioning. And in life again, mind also is there. That's why it is coming out one by one. Okay. So life involved in brings back into manifestation the mind, bring into manifestation as mind the consciousness, which is a real self of the force and which never ceases to exist in it, even when unmanifest. We know also that mind is an inferior power of the original conscious knowledge. Now, he is using different words to explain supermind. Okay? Now, we have to be very careful and understand, oh, conscious knowledge, but it's the original one. So, when you say original conscious force, you can, conscious knowledge, you can think of supermind. So, these words are very interesting because it gives indications as to how to think. Okay, so original conscious knowledge of supermind, a power to which life acts as an instrumental energy. Okay, so the supermind, the chit shakti, is an instrument for this to act. Okay, so it's an instrument descending through supermind. For descending through supermind, consciousness or chit represents itself as mind, force of consciousness or tapas represents itself as life. There you are. Chit Shakti, they are together, but Chit creates the consciousness or Chit represents itself as mind, force or consciousness or tapas represents itself as life. Okay? So, but here he is saying that in some places Chit Shakti is the one that he says sometimes that Sat is consciousness. Okay, but here he is saying because they are all one at the highest level. Okay, so it's a little tricky. Here he is saying Chit becomes mind and Shakti becomes life. Okay, so we take it at that as that becomes. In another place he says the mind is actually coming from supermind. And supermind is the power of, we discussed that. Huh? Oh. Supermind is the power of Satchidananda. Mm.
The power by which it manifests.
Yes, that's right. So, now it represents it.
And he gives a sort of image here. He says, descending through supermind, chit tapas comes like this. So, if we imagine chit tapas as 2 levels above the supermind. So like it's descending through supermind, and then through the supermind action, it like splits like this sort of. And the chit becomes mind and the tapas element becomes life.
Yes.
So it's a very visual image, descending through supermind.
Yes. I also like to put it another way, it's interesting. But you think of supermind as a prism. Okay. The one light which is there, it comes through and the prism breaks it up. So the prism is the overmind consciousness actually, yes. But essentially it is supermind, yes. And it breaks up into all this. Okay? So, therefore, no, we have to go above, na?
Mind by its separation.
Mind by its separation from its own higher reality in supermind. Now he is talking about supermind. Earlier he said chit. Now he is saying supermind. Because these differences are our creations. For our clarity of thinking, we have to think of it that way. But actually, chit is mind, is consciousness. So mind, consciousness and chit are essentially the same. Even substance is really the same. Because he says very clearly, don't think of Satchidananda as three different things. There is only one.
That's why I
see. The substance itself is consciousness and itself is force. Alright? So, mind, by its separation from its own higher reality in supermind, gives life the appearance of division, and by its further involution in its own life force, becomes subconscious in life, and thus gives the outward appearance of an inconscient force to its material workings. By the time it comes down here, the matter seems to be inconscient, but it is not so. There is force, but it has gone to sleep. Or rather, you can say also that it is involved, or you can say it is gone to sleep, or it is. You can also say, in another way, you can also put it, because when you speak of Purusha and Prakriti, you can say, Prakriti is dominating Purusha. Because I am saying this because in his plays, okay, in his plays, whether it be Eric or whether it be Vasavadatta, okay, he speaks of this. Actually, you have to understand that Sri Aurobindo, when he is writing these romantic things, it is not romance. It is Purusha Prakriti, play of Purusha and Prakriti, okay. So this is something that you want us to understand. So, in the Vasavadatta,
in several poems also.
Yes.
There is a poem called Ishvara Ishvari.
Yes, that's right. And they play. They are constantly playing with each other. Their eyes interchange. Yes. He says in Savitri.
Yes.
Okay. So.
The secret knowledge.
People many times see it as like.
No, even in the secret knowledge. He, the whole wide world is only he and she.
Yes, that's right. Okay, so now I go back to, I'm saying because dominating, because in Vasavadatta, Vatsa is the prince. Okay? Note interestingly, he doesn't have parents. Why? Because the self is unborn. Purusha is unborn. So he has no parents. He has only got Yugandharayan, who is a minister to him. So the minister is the mind. Okay. So, and he, Vasavadatta, is saying in the beginning, I am going to conquer him. I am going to bring him under my control. He is going to be my slave. That's why she takes her attitude. In Eric also the same thing happens. Finally she comes and becomes very calmly, quietly, Vatsa makes her his slave. Okay, so this is Sri Aurobindo saying that finally the Purusha has to control Prakriti. And what is Prakriti?
Force.
The soul must control body, mind, life. This is his own thing. So there also it is a play of that. He is putting it in dramatic form, but he means ultimately not mere escape like the ascetic. You don't have to simply escape from your body, mind, life and be satisfied. You have to become master of this. Okay. And this is also interesting because nowadays many people it sounds very reasonable. One must live in harmony with nature. This is what they say. Sounds very good. Vivekananda says, certainly not. You must be master of nature.
Don't submit to it.
Yes. And this Sri Aurobindo also says the same thing. You have to become master of nature. Without damaging her. Right now in science, what we are doing? We are becoming master of nature. We are taming rivers. We are using sunlight. We are using wind power. But we are damaging nature also. The environment we are damaging very badly. That should not happen. We have to become master without damaging nature. So, that's interesting. So, you can say that matter has completely brought consciousness under its control. You can say that. But consciousness is divine. It doesn't want to remain imprisoned. So it breaks out. And that breaking out, one by one, is evolution. So, you can see how complicated the ideas are. You have to sort of bring out the latent things that are there. Okay? Therefore, the inconscience, the inertia, the atomic disaggregation of matter must have their source in this all-dividing and self-involving action of mind by which our universe came into being. Okay? And what is that level? Elsewhere he has said, is the overmind. It's the overmind that is the last step of ascent in the of ignorance. Above overmind, there is no ignorance. Okay? Therefore, the inconscience, the inertia, the atomic disaggregation of matter must have their source in this all-dividing and self-involving action of mind by which our universe came into being. As mind is only a final action of supermind in the descent, okay? Now he is talking of supermind. Now he is not saying chit, okay? Mind is only a final action of supermind in the descent towards creation, and life an action of conscious force working in the conditions of the ignorance created by the descent, this descent of mind. So matter as we know it is only the final form taken by conscious being. Replace conscious being by sat or substance as a result of their working. So therefore, another definition, matter is substance of the one conscious being. He has added one, remember, huh? That means it is matter has become many, whereas this is one, one conscious being, phenomenally divided within itself by the action of a universal mind. Now he has put also the word phenomenal. It is not real division, it is only phenomenal division. It appears to be divided. From certain consciousness, you can see that this appearance is only superficial. It is not real. I told you about the kaleidoscope. Okay? It's only an appearance. All the forms that you see are only appearances. Okay? So, as mind, we have finished that. So, matter is substance of the one conscious being, phenomenally divided within itself. Again, not outside itself, but within itself, by the action of a universal mind. And that universal mind is the overmind, what he's saying. A division which the individual mind repeats and dwells in, but which does not abrogate or at all diminish the unity of spirit or the unity of energy or the real unity of matter. Unity of matter is universal matter. Universal energy is prana, which is there as a whole world. Only energy is there. And finally, you have only the world of mind, which is there in the universal level. So, from this universal level, apparently individual formations are there. And you are a form of matter. At the end of your life, your matter goes back into universal matter. Your body will go back into universal matter. Similarly, your prana also is a small formation of universal prana. It goes back into universal prana and is recycled for other prana, just like the body. So this is what he is saying in the... So that way seems, if you go a little deeper and think of all the... and substitute some words, okay, then it becomes easy to understand what he is saying. Okay? So that word phenomenon also is very important. You have to understand what is phenomenon. Phenomenon is transience, that which is beginning and ending. An event, if you want. You can use the word event. All events begin at a certain level, end at a certain level.
It's a Greek root is, according to the root, it is to show. It says neuter, PRP, passive of phenein, to show. So the root means to show. So phenomenon is something just to show. Appearance.
That's right. So again, you come back to the same idea. Yeah.
The root of matter, that way, is the Sanskrit word matri, that from which everything originates. I wonder what is the root of the word substance, because this chapter is dealing with that. I'll just check what is the
substance.
Root of substance.
Okay. In Sanskrit, very clear roots are there with meanings, but in English, etymology.
It says to stand under.
Substance.
Stands.
That's what I thought.
To stand under.
Yeah.
So that which is the...
matter is the lowest.
Basis on which...
substance.
Yeah. Which is standing under everything, that is substance.
In fact, you have the separate word stance also.
Yeah.
Stance means to stand. Okay.
Wow.
So, interesting.
Now you'll never forget what substance means.
Yeah. That's why he was on saying substance or matter. Okay, he says that. Huh?